and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Phil, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. Have you ever heard of the phrase culture eats strategy for breakfast? If not, well, it's a saying made famous by management guru Peter Drucker, who is communicating the importance of a workplace culture. Now, while he wasn't saying that strategy is unimportant, he was saying that an engaging and empowering culture is a surer route to organisational success. Now, while we believe at McCrindle in the sentiment of this famous phrase, we've actually got our own slightly nerdier version, and that is research eats strategy for breakfast. So in today's episode, we're going to be talking about what we mean by that adaptation of that famous phrase, why research is so powerful, how data can help us make decisions, and what you need to keep in mind if you want to lead with data-driven insights. And joining me today is McCrindle's founder and principal, Mark McCrindle, who is an influential thought leader, is the author of 5 books, and is also a futurist. And if you want to find out more about what that term means, you can loop back to our first episode of the podcast where we talk all about that. So, Mark, welcome back.
Thanks, Ash. Good to be with you.
We're very excited to talk about such a nerdy topic and sort of a play on this famous phrase. And it's interesting, I guess, when I was thinking about this episode and what we were going to share, and I think about, I guess, what I share with people about what I do for work, they always say, you know, wow, that must be so interesting and you must love what you do, I guess, because I talk about it with a lot of passion, and it's absolutely right. I do love my job. I love this line of work, and I also often get asked, how did you get into this area, this area of social research? It's not really market research, but it's social research. And my own story is that, like many sort of fresh out of school 18-year-olds, I didn't know what I wanted to do, but I knew what topics I loved, and I loved learning and being curious, and I thought university was the pathway for me. And I actually studied a Bachelor of Arts in communication, and instead of other areas like PR or journalism, I went into the area of social inquiry. And it's interesting because I feel like our current world at McCrindle is that kind of degree in a job. So it was very fitting. And I know that not everyone sort of works out, you know, into the workforce from university in that way. But I guess for you, Mark, as the founder of McCrindle, that question means so much more. So how did you get into this pretty niche area of research and start a social research company?
Yeah, well, there's not a school's careers advisor that says social research is one of the options. You know, it's not really on the job description that a lot of people have in mind. But like all of us here, I have a real interest in people, indeed a fascination about people. And so that led me after school to head off to do a psychology degree, which is really the study of the individual psyche. My postgraduate studies have been all around sociology, and that's the study of societies and groups. And I guess the crossroads of both of those, the individual psyche meets the collective society, is where social research sits, you know, and we analyze people as individuals, but people as groups and how they interact and make decisions. We're fascinated by not only their attitudes and their perspectives and their sentiment, but also their behaviors, what they actually do. And it's great to collect all of that data of individuals through surveys and in-depth interviews, and of societies through focus groups and data analytics that look at, you know, behaviors and choices, and to collect all of that, to do population mapping and forecasting, and all of that gives us a real understanding of where we've come from, where we are, and where we're going as a society. And I just find that endlessly fascinating. I know you do, Ash, and all of our team does. And to be able to collect those insights and then to present those to organizations to help them understand their own staff community or customer base or context or industry or society, you know, is of great use and a great privilege for us.
It really is. And I know in an insider sort of joke we often have with our team, which needs a bit of context and explanation, is that we're kind of all professional people watchers, and everyone's like, oh, like you cringe a little bit where you're like, what do you mean? It's a stalker vibes? No, it's not. It is about being curious. And I know even for our team, like, well, in our open plan office, we'll be sitting there and someone will say, hey, guys, I've got to read you this interesting stat from this study that we're doing, or this survey, because it is just fascinating stuff that we get to look at every day. And I know a lot of our team are very passionate, like you and I, about the topics we get to survey and conduct research on. And speaking of that, Mark, do you have one, or I guess a study that comes to mind for you that we've conducted that really stands out to you? Mm.
I mean, so many when I think about our different studies where we've been able to develop instruments and segmentations and models to give tools to organisations. But one comes to mind is some work we did for an aged care organisation that's particularly got a focus on looking after Australians living with dementia. And if we think about the aged care options, you know, there's that home care, which isn't really appropriate for someone with dementia. And then you've got the institutional care, which can be problematic because it's almost like a hospital setting. And so they had a vision of almost like house-based care with on a campus different houses with six or seven residents and professional care in each of those houses, and it's sort of deinstitutionalizing aged care. The only problem was they had to make sure they got the right compatible residents together in those homes, because it is almost like feels like a house setting, even though it's on a care campus. Because, you know, if you get someone who's a really neat freak and loves minimalism combined with a resident who likes the lived-in comfort, a little bit of junk around sort of approach, you're going to get a clash. Or someone that's really, you know, by the rules, and someone that say, we'll make it up as we go along. Again, you'll get a clash of resonance of mindset. And so it was our job. We were asked to come up with a survey that residents and their families could complete that'll help place them, if you like, into communities or home groups where there was compatibility and where they, if you like, shared a similar worldview or archetype. And so we, through this study, developed a 22-question survey that they would fill in before being placed in the home and an archetype framework. And the results of that have been fantastic because, you know, by asking questions around, for example, you know, what's your view on the role of government or the role of religious faith and financial values and even a little bit around politics or community or gender roles, all these sorts of things, you can, in a short survey, really understand what sort of worldview, perspective, and outlook they have. And that does help with compatibility. Anyway, the results of this, as they've applied over the last couple of years, have been phenomenal. And this organization has won many awards for the innovation and the outcomes that it's brought these residents. It's the tool they've used to create harmony with placements, as well as the outcomes for the residents, have been phenomenal. And it's now something they're rolling out across Australia and around the world. So it's a great privilege to work on a project like this. And that's just an example of what we're all about as an organization, empowering human flourishing and equipping organizations to create harmonious communities. And that ticked all of those boxes, as well as being very cutting edge and innovative and creating a tool that they can use ongoing. So, you know, when projects like that come together, it's very gratifying.
It really is. And I remember that project when we were working on it as an organization. And like you said, it ticked so many of those boxes for us. And it's amazing. You use the word privilege, and that's the word I was thinking of when you were giving that answer. And to be able to impact decisions being made that is evidence-based and founded on research to help people live in aged care facilities that really are better suited to them. It's definitely a privilege. And I know for me, one study that we've conducted more recently this year was something that we developed called the Kindness Index for Helgers who often are creating bread. And it was really interesting insights about the kindness of strangers and the kindness of Australians, especially in the current context of the pandemic. And spoiler alert, we will have a whole episode planned on that kindness research with one of the teams. So very much looking forward to delving into that and exploring how Australians are kind and how we can be more kind and make a difference in people's lives. And like you said, to enable human flourishing, which is what we put our hand to in this niche area of social research. I guess, Mark, this whole episode is being like sort of named as Culture Eats Strategy for Breakfast. And I wanted to get down to the crux of that and ask you point blank, why does research eat strategy for breakfast?
Because research needs to come before strategy. Research is more important than strategy in that, firstly, it needs to precede it. You know, in a time sense, you need to make sure the strategy is based on research. You need to know where you are in context before you can develop the strategy as to where you're going. So it needs to come first. That's the reason. But it also needs to come first because it's actually more important than strategy. And an example, I mean, if an organization doesn't have a strategy, but they really understand where they sit in the marketplace, what their customers think, what their strengths are, the terrain in which they're operating, then they will actually make decisions naturally that will lead them forward, even without a strategy, compared to, let's say, a company that has a really clear strategy, but a strategy that is not based on research or insights or data or evidence. They will head very efficiently and very quickly in the wrong direction, chances are. So your research needs to inform the strategy, needs to guide the strategy, and it's essential in that way. In fact, you know, if we were to use a metaphor, strategy is like sort of finding your direction. You're out there going for a walk. Strategy is the destination, and it's the pathway to get you there. But research, if we think about this metaphor, is the map and the compass and the GPS and the binoculars as well. And so I would rather go with someone on a trek, on a hike, who had the equipment, who knew where they are and where they'd come from, where they were going in terms of the terrain. They knew the lay of the land. Even if they didn't have a particular route in mind, they would end up in a better way, an understanding of the weather and the terrain, and they'd be packed appropriately, than someone who knows where they want to go. That's the hill that we're going to get to, and then we're going to go down, and we're going to go around, and we're going to go up, but they've got no idea of the terrain and indeed where they currently sit on the map. So research guides, informs, directs, and gives feedback on the strategy, and that's why it's so important. In fact, the same management guru who said that leadership eats strategy for breakfast, Peter Drucker, that you mentioned, and we're taking that and saying, well, research eats strategy for breakfast, so research is even more important. He also said, what gets measured gets done. And so if we want to get things done, if we want to get outcomes in our organizations, we need measurement. And measurement is really data and research and insights. It comes from collecting up the signals of where we're at and how we're traveling, and that then will help us get things done. I would add one thing to Peter Drucker's quote there. Not only what gets measured gets done, we believe what gets measured and effectively communicated gets done, because we are in a world of information overload. We are drowning in data. So we don't need just more data. What we need is clarified data, distilled data, clearly communicated data, visually communicated data. Because if we have that, then we and our team members and the frontline workers, all of us, can understand clearly where we're sitting, what the direction is. They can know the lay of the land, and they can move forward appropriately. They can take the action because it's being measured and communicated. And that's why we're so strong, not only on collecting the data, on conducting the research, on getting the insights, on understanding the lay of the land, but on communicating that in a clear, succinct way, in a visual way. I remember when I was just beginning and I'd have meetings with people talking about research, and they'd reach over, pull off the shelf, well, here's the research from 3 years ago, and it didn't to me look like it had been much leafed through. And here's last year's research, and they'd pull something else off the shelf. And I didn't want to do any research that was going to be shelved. It was going to be done. And then, oh, we've done that, tick that, I'll put that on the shelf with last year's one and the year before's one. I want a research that would sit on an infographic, you know, research that you could put on a wall, that you could communicate in a 10-minute summary. And that's what we focused on. And that's, I think, been really clarifying for our clients. And I think that's the sort of research that helps us not only communicate it, but then measure it and head off into a strategy because of it.
Yeah, and I have, you know, I obviously believe and I agree with everything you said, Mark, but I've also seen it firsthand. And I know our team have as well. When you deliver research to a client, we're often commissioned by a range of different organizations in different sectors and industries, which is why I think this work is so interesting. But also, you know, we're talking and we're reporting back the insights about different topics or different aspects of an organization to the board or to the leaders. And they're just sitting there with wide eyes open, ready to sort of absorb that and then take the strategy from there. And we do it in our own organization when you've got research that provides the context around what you're trying to do or what you're trying to achieve. It's just so helpful. And on that sort of basis, Mark, I mean, I wonder if there are people out there who don't have the same affection maybe for research that we do, or respect or admiration for it, perhaps they're a little bit skeptical. And, you know, even in politics, maybe when people think surveys or polls or focus group, they think politics. And maybe there's kind of that tokenistic, or focus groups is a dirty word, sort of perspective. What do you have to say to people who might be a little bit cynical of research?
Well, I'll share a few thoughts as to why it's important. I think something else that falls into that category comes to my mind is not only, we want to make true decisions based on our intuition or based on our experience. But other people just find research boring, or information or data not particularly exciting. So, you know, to everyone listening to this, you tuned into a podcast where we're talking data. Well done, because it is a bit of a boring word, a boring topic. Let's face it. So we sort of change the language and help people see data or research or information for what it really is. And our three phrase summary of what we're about in 9 words is discover the insights, because insights, it's not just data, but it's insights. It's actionable information. And it's discovering that. I mean, it's exciting to look at a pattern of data and find a trend, find something that sits outside of the normal range. It's exciting to get back those surveys and to divide it up by generation or segment and say, hey, here is some gold. This particular group are loving it. Or to look at a trend and to say, wow, we're really noticing this is on the way down or this is on the way up. And that's discovering insights. And then we say after that, we want to tell the story. So we get excited by discovering these insights, these patterns, these ideas, this evidence-based information. And then we want to tell the story, and we can't wait to get in front of the client or write it up and say, hey, did you know this? Let me tell you about that from your own data. And that's exciting for them to hear that story. And it is a story. You know, it's not just a spreadsheet. It's not just pages of text. It's a story to tell. It's insights to be discovered. And the final thing we say is guide the journey. And research is at its best when it leads to action, when it informs strategy, when it leads to change, when it has impacts. So it's not passive. It doesn't just sit there. It actually leads to transformation if we can guide the journey based on the story of the research and having discovered the right insight. So I'd say 3 reasons why it's essential to be research-based, to make decisions based on data. And number one is because evidence is more important than opinion. Everyone's got an opinion, and those opinions or those feelings or those perceptions, they have a place. But evidence is more important than opinion. And we are just so clear on that. You know, beliefs, that they have their place, but something that is based on reason and that can be explained and can be evidenced to others is more important than someone's feelings, which can be shaped by their own personal experience or their own emotion or the influence of others that may not be appropriate influence. And so, you know, organizations that are led on the gut intuition, they're led by a leader who says, well, don't ask me the question, we're heading in this way. I find that's sort of a scary leadership. That's autocratic. That can have misapplied power. You can have the charismatic leader take people wholly down the wrong direction because there is no evidence. There's no decision making based on data that someone can hold them accountable to. It's just based on the power of their personality, their rank, or their authority. And no one else gets a voice in that. I find that unhelpful for organizations. And it gives an external source of truth. It gives a validation. It allows governance boards or other leaders or managers, or even those on the front line, to have that evidence base and to check in to see whether we're heading in the right direction because of that. So it gives a shared reservoir of truth. That's the power of it. So that's why evidence is more important than opinion. The second reason we believe in research is that it creates a shared understanding, or I'd say it this way, a shared understanding is foundational to cohesion. So what we need for our organizations is to cohese, to connect, to have a sense of belonging and togetherness and unity. You know, we're in organizations that are very diverse, and that's important. But amidst all of that diversity, we need unity towards the common goal, the task, the outcome. And what gives that unity is the shared understanding. And on what is that shared understanding? It can't be based on my experience, can't be based on my gut feeling, my intuition. That's not shared, but the evidence, the platform of evidence that we articulate, that we can show, that is shared, can be understood, and we can all stand on that platform of evidence. We can share that together. We can say, this we believe because we have seen it. The data proves it. And that's the sort of foundation that creates that cohesion. And that's what organizations are about. It's even there in the word organization. It's got the root word organism, which is one body. You know, it operates as one. And if we're all going off our gut, if we're all going off our sentiment, we're going to have many different directions. We're not going to operate as one. Even the word, you know, corporation comes from that word corpus, meaning one body. So organizations, companies, we need to operate as one. And what helps us cohese as one? It's that shared understanding. And that brings unity to the diversity. It brings collectivism amongst the disparate nature of us. We all talk about inclusivity in our organizations, but that's only half the sentence. We're inclusive to what? What builds that inclusivity? What drives that connectivity? And it's got to be the shared understanding, the platform on which we all stand. And I think that's best when it's evidence that is that. And my third reason is that insights are essential to driving direction. So we've said organizations need to be based on evidence because that is more superior to opinion. And what brings the shared understanding, the collective view is the data, is the evidence. But thirdly, that insights are essential to driving direction, because the goal of an organization is not to exist. The goal of an organization is to do something, to head somewhere and have impacts and to make a difference. And what drives that difference? As we discussed earlier, it's not strategy. Strategy is necessary, but it is informed or driven by the research. So the research or the insights actually are the catalyst for us heading in a direction, because now we know the map, we know the lay of the land, and we know where to head. Without that, we'd just be either not going anywhere or wandering in circles. So it's clarifying, it's enlightening, it shines a light, it shows us where we are and where we can go. And it's that evidence that is the means by which we can head somewhere. So the platform from which leaders lead has to be evidence or data or information rather than, you know, just the current whim, the latest fad, because then we can flip-flop all over the place. And what else is going to drive the activity of an organization? I hope it's not just chasing profits, because if profits are essential for an organization, but it's a bit like breathing. You know, it's essential to exist, but it's not why we exist. Why we exist, breathing, we need the breathing, but why we exist is to do something and to achieve something. And so it is for organizations. They'll exist with profits, but they do something because of the research, the insights which power the direction and enable them to have those impacts, to measure those impacts, to be accountable for the direction that they're headed, and to hopefully be on a pathway of continuous improvement because of the ongoing research or data feedback that they're getting. So evidence overpowers the opinions. It's the collective point for shared understanding, and it's essential to driving directions. That's why we're big fans and believe in research and the scientific method that achieves its outcome.
Absolutely. There was so much gold in that answer, Mark. And I think for me, something else maybe I would add, or maybe just rephrase what you just said in terms of, I guess, the power of research in making decisions, is that I often say to people that research either confirms or denies a hypothesis that you might have about something. And oftentimes leaders, especially when you're talking about, you know, leaders in a specific industry or about a specific product that they're experts in, they might need to confirm or deny that. And what I have found in my own career and experience is that it's not enough to be sort of, yeah, like you said, relying on your own opinions, especially in the current context with fake news and everyone questioning leaders' authority, which is, I think, helpful. But it's really powerful in that way. And I remember early on in my career, when I was starting to do a bit of public speaking, and I was, you know, a mid-20-something young woman and a bit, maybe feeling a bit like the imposter syndrome and not having enough confidence. I remember, Mark, you actually said to me, you said, you're able to go out and speak not on your own subjective 20-something-year-old thoughts, but on the authority of the research. And I think it actually helps to future-proof leaders in that way and to take some of the pressure off, know that you have to know everything, but it's actually relying on that research-based, evidence-based approach where you go, this is going to inform strategy, and that I think that can help us as individuals as well have confidence in decisions that we're making.
And it's a humbling disposition to have, you know, as you said, Ashley, you know, we're not standing on our own power of personality or particular internal knowledge or something that we've dreamed up, which tomorrow might be a different direction. But actually it's this evidence. It's something external to us. It's objective from us. And I'd rather be led by a leader who stands on that platform. And then it's a platform that can be shared. It's a platform that we can, as we get more evidence, more data, bring others onto, and they can lead because the truth, the power, the evidence, the direction is beyond ourselves. And so we need to be custodians of that research. And I think even for, you know, expert leaders, it's something to remember and to often defer to is, again, the external evidence, the research, not start to believe our own press release and think that we're behind it all and we're giving the right insights and direction. It needs to be external. I mean, a famous example of this is Steve Jobs, and far be it from me to critique his leadership, who achieved some pretty amazing things. But famously, he was not into research and focus groups because he knew what the customer wanted, and he knew from a gut intuition what would work and what wouldn't, which is interesting because he never believed in the plus size phones. He was, you know, phones are to be portable. We got the iPad if you want a larger thing. They're just to be portable and to fit in the pocket. But after he passed on and new leadership came, they then brought in the plus size phone. They couldn't do that while he was at the helm. And now it makes up more than 30% of all phone sales, of iPhone sales. So the customer knew something that even the leader at the time didn't. And it's a great example to consult. It might have been true in the past. It may not be true today. So we need to constantly go back to the market to understand the lay of the land. This is true for us. Leaders have had a bit of experience under our belt. And we can be really assertive because we know what the case is, because it was like that when we began 10 years ago, but it's not like that anymore. And that's why continuous research and understanding that is important. Now, it's not being gutless in research and not making a decision without enough research. You know, we do have to, as leaders, be bold, set direction, and lead, not just follow. But hopefully that leadership can be informed by the research, empowered by the research, and not something that we hide behind either. That brings us to that point you began by making, Ash, that you know, we sometimes hear the negative side of research where people say, oh, you know, that's a poll-driven leader, or that politician only makes decisions when they've focus-grouped the life out of it. You know, we don't want to be like that either. We need to be bold and be strong and take charge, but hopefully not just based on our own power of personality, but based on what the consultative approach of the gathering of that evidence, of that research, of that survey approach can bring. Because that's democracy. You know, that's collecting the views of others, not just running down a pathway based on our own perspective.
Mm-hmm. And it reminds me of a quote that I've heard you say before, Mark, which is, the smartest person in the room is the room itself. And I love that. And I think you're right. It's democracy and it's getting other people's opinions and perspectives. And we talked about this a few episodes back, even I think when we talked about the tendency people have to stereotype people of a certain age or a generation. And I often encourage clients to say, and I guess it's the research of me doing this, but saying, well, why don't you ask your clients or your customers or your consumers what they prefer or what they want, rather than just making assumptions based on what that is. And I guess that's where sort of the power of consumer research and not just consumer research, but any research of any cohort or community really does empower the people who are making those strategic decisions. And that's why research eats strategy for breakfast. I wanted to just delve into something that you mentioned earlier on, because obviously it should be clear to anyone listening to this episode that we believe in the power of research. But some people might be surprised to know that when you started McCrindle as a company, your first hire wasn't a researcher, but it was actually a graphic designer. Could you elaborate and explain a little bit why you made that decision?
Yeah, because if all we're doing is collecting data and not focused on the consumption of that data, how it's going to be communicated or translated, then we're not going to have impacts with that data, as powerful as that data may be. And I'm into the data. I like writing the surveys. I love analyzing the stats when they come back and trying to find the insights in that. But I know that I'm passionate about the statistics. A lot of people aren't. And so we've got to find a way of translating that language of statistics into an understanding for most people. Because research is only helpful when it's in the hands of the people who can apply it, who can make a difference. And that's not normally the person who commissioned the research or the board who gets a copy of the research. It's normally people on the front line, people who are actually getting the job done in the organization. And they're not going to read through that 60-page report. They are not interested in that cross-tabulated spreadsheet table. What they want is the infographic, the visual, the video summary. And so it's how we communicate the research that is as important as the research findings and what we've collected. And that's where I think there's even other forms. You know, we use a lot of infographics and visualization forms. We communicate in spoken forms and do video summaries and animated videos. But even other ways of getting that across through instruments or dashboards or interactive websites, splash pages. There are different ways of communicating. You know, putting the data on a wall or translating it in sound bites or podcasts, whatever the medium. Let's engage with it, because research is at its best when it's not just read, but it's seen, it's understood, and it's in some ways lived. And that brings us to actioning it. That's what it's all about.
Oh, absolutely. And both you and I, Mark, have delivered TED Talks on this exact topic, storytelling and why research needs to be accessible to people. And I know that you get feedback like this as well. You know, both you and I are regularly out speaking at conferences, and we might be marketed as the demographer or the futurist or the data analyst. And I guess they don't conjure exactly the most engaging, maybe stereotypes. And oftentimes I get feedback about our sorts of presentations, which are very infographic based, and there's lots of slides and it's very visual. And therefore often the feedback is that it's very engaging. And I have heard more than once at the end of a conference presentation, someone, you know, walks up and says, "Great job. To be honest, I didn't think that was going to be very interesting." And you're like, okay, I'll take the backhanded compliment. It's not what I was thinking, but okay. But it's because oftentimes the word data can, yeah, be boring. And it can be just not a story that people can relate to or are inspired by. It's kind of just hypothetical and maybe too technical and not relatable enough. And that's why we've got a great team of, you know, designers, and shout out to our team who really do invest and work hard at making research and data accessible and interesting and inspiring. And yeah, for the infographics that we are quite well known for.
Yeah. And we love data that really can be set free. We're big fans. We're always saying to our clients, let's get this report produced in a way that can go to everyone in the organization. It ought not to sit at the board or executive table here. You know, we've surveyed the staff for their opinions. Let's get it back to all of them. We've surveyed the community. Let's make sure this is public. We've surveyed the Australian community. Let's make sure we put this on social media or get it back to the Australian public, who's, after all, it's their data. We've asked them for their opinion. This is their stuff. Let's democratize it by setting it free and getting it out in the media so they can read about it. And we're big believers in that. Let's not lock it up. Let's set it free, because the further it goes, the more impacts it can have, the more application it can receive. And that's what it's all about. So to collect it, communicate it effectively, and set it free. And that's the best way of bringing about outcomes from data.
Absolutely. And we, I think, as researchers or those communicating anything in the 21st century, do need to work hard and put in that extra effort, because we are all living in times of information overload and message saturation. And, you know, we often incorporate in our presentations the TLDR sort of acronym that some people use, you know, too long, didn't read, or the TLDR version. And maybe with data, it's, you know, TBDR, too boring, didn't read. So we need to make sure that it is interesting and so it can get that cut through and then inform strategy and make society a better place through whatever sort of means that it's doing that. It's been so interesting to talk about this, Mark. You know, we're very passionate about it. I guess a lot of people might be sitting there and wondering sort of what's the takeaway or the practical next step. What would you recommend based on our conversation today? If someone has been inspired, they now believe in the power of research and that it does eat strategy for breakfast, what's your practical step or one action point for someone listening today?
Well, quite simply, it's to do your research, you know, before making a decision, before developing the strategy before implementing the new approach, do your research, get the input and the opinion of others. And that can be done through simple surveys. It can be done by asking questions. You know, we call it in-depth interviews so we can charge money for it, but it's just conversation. It's just having a chat, you know, do that, you know, consult is the point. And when we have got that feedback, that information on the table, when we've discussed it together, then we can make those decisions. Now, the decision might be contrary to what everyone wants. So we've surveyed the staff and they all want this. Great. We're not going to do that because as leaders, we've got a higher calling or bigger responsibility or our values are guiding us here or we've got a bigger vision to achieve that. Fine. At least you will know what they think and then you'll be able to, when you communicate the alternate direction, communicate why it's not in accordance with what the majority actually want. It's regardless of whether we go with what the polling or research suggests people want or whether we go against it, we still need to do it because that's going to help us in the communication. And as we often tell our clients, you know, research is a communication activity in itself, even the very nature of consulting with the staff. And not everyone's going to fill it in or the customers. They appreciate it. Wow, you actually want my opinion. I'll fill in this survey. You want to hear from me. You actually care enough. It says in the preamble here that you're looking to make a decision. And so it's important that you hear from me. I appreciate that. So thank you. I work now for an organization that is consultative, that wants my opinion, that is making decisions with my input. And so leadership is not remote. They're not making decisions regardless of what everyone else wants. They do want to be informed by it. So do your research. And then I would say communicate based on that research, communicate the direction, consult widely, communicate that data in a way that'll make sense, that'll be understandable, and that people can feel that they have got it and therefore understand the reasons for the new direction. And when we've got that, we'll make better decisions. We'll have that shared platform on which we all stand. It's going to outweigh anyone's opinion because there's always people with opinions that are going to cut across the direction we're going. We say, yeah, well, appreciate that opinion, but here's what the evidence says. And of course, it'll drive that direction, that momentum, and that matters. And as does the strategy, as do the values. But, you know, the values are guideposts. The values don't do anything. They guide us. That's what we check back to. It's the strategy that takes us in a direction, but that is all informed, pre-informed by the research, which ultimately is king.
Absolutely. And I love your answer there. And I feel like it was really wise because something I'm often thinking about when I encourage people to do research and conduct research and ask questions is that you need to be led and guided by it, but you don't need to just make decisions based on what the majority want. Like you said, you need that wisdom and that insight, probably why you're a leader and the expertise. And I think what it does do, like you shared, is it makes you feel informed and you're equipped as a leader because you know how people feel or what the customer or community or cohort is thinking because you've taken the time to ask them and you've invested in that. And if you don't have the capability to do that, hopefully we've got a lot of resources that are available for people. We do a lot of research in a lot of specific sectors, like we've got big sort of industry research about the not-for-profit sector, about the education sector, and even just of general consumers and people of different ages, what different generations think. We've got whole reports about understanding the future consumer. So hopefully, yeah, people can at least do some background reading on those sorts reports if they can't sort of run out and do a focus group, but even just asking questions and being curious, I think, is a great place to start. But thank you so much for the chat today, Mark. I hope everyone has been inspired by our chat to become a little bit more of the data nerd and the research-based approach.
Thanks, Ash.
And looking ahead, I'm always very excited because we've got some great episodes and interesting topics coming up for you on the podcast. And if you're interested to find out more about that research I just mentioned or just general insights about the future, you can always subscribe to this podcast. You can watch the video recording on YouTube and you can visit our website, which is mccrindle.com.au, or follow us on socials. So thanks once again for listening. Bye for now.